A motel out on the Queensway for now.
For now.
And we have the rent paid until
tomorrow.
You have the rent paid until tomorrow.
Yeah.
Okay.
And no way of paying it from tomorrow, unless I come down and turn into a prostitute again.
Angel and Rob are looking for help from the John Howard Society. They need a place to stay and they need to get off crack.
What am I going to do?
Okay, then I'm just going to call ERF to see what they can do for us. My name is Lawrence and I'm calling from John Howard Society. I have a client with me. She's right here with me and her fiancé. And I was wondering, she's addicted to crack cocaine. And she's just been clean for a day. And I was wondering if it's possible for me to refer them over to you.
Don't look so happy.
Wednesday, May the 20th, is that okay?
Yep.
10:45?
Okay.
That'll be fine. Right. Okay.
Lawrence Niamali has tried to help Angel before.
Okay.
She let him down.
All right then. Please, please, don't forget to go for the appointment.
Oh, no. Please, please, don't worry. Lawrence, did you get $4?
No, it's against our policy.
Is it? That's terrible.
I don't like the policy.
That's not a good policy.
2 weeks later, the Addiction Research Foundation awaits Angel for her 10:45 appointment. An hour passes. Angel and Rob are sleeping in the park near Dundas and Sherburne.
I was sleeping.
All day, right here.
Just how I forgot about it. I was busy dreaming of life.
Have you guys been using?
Oh, yeah. Since we got back down here, yeah, we've been using steady. Can't help but that's all that's in this fucking park. Best.
Ruby Wood Twyman is trying to raise kids in a crack zone.
They're little enough that they haven't been approached to sell it, to buy it. But my fear is not necessarily that they would get hurt directly, but that they'd end up in the crossfire somehow. My husband has had words with a couple of dealers on the street, and I think he was upstairs and he heard some yelling and he came out onto the balcony. It was one of the younger, you know, 25-year-old dealers was hassling an old man, cursing and swearing at him and stuff. And the kids were playing in the front yard. And my husband said, you know, can you watch the language? And Buddy said, I own the street. You get on that side of the fence and stay there and just stay off my fucking street.
The homeowners are hitting the crack trade from another direction. They've been putting pressure on bars that allow drug action, getting their licenses lifted. This place is closed. Now they want the whole block dried up.
Hi, good afternoon. The free Chinese food.
Thomas Ho is desperate to stop them. He owns the building with the closed bar. He's evicted the people who ran it, and he wants the license back for his own new restaurant.
Looks like a clean place.
Okay, thank you.
I like Chinese food.
Okay, you're welcome.
You are welcome to come down to my restaurant. And right now I'm applying for the liquor license because I just want a few hours serving liquor.
Okay, the problem is we have been subjected to the worst kind of abuse possibly known to mankind. And the reality is, Mr. Ho, those two addresses. You know, I listened to the talk on the street, and they're just waiting for you to get your liquor license, just waiting to come back into your place. They like that corner. They can see everything from that corner. And I'm sorry, Mr. Ho, but that block on Dundas needs a rest.
We have spent a solid year working to get rid of the problems that were created in your premises.
Yeah.
And we cannot allow that kind of business to go on again.
Because of the residents' lobbying, the Liquor Commission slaps a 2-year moratorium on liquor sales for the entire block. The residents' other target is a little trickier. It's the church. They think it's supporting the drug and sex trade.
Well, our battles with the church have been for years. They cater to the homeless and socially isolated. It's supposed to be a place where they can come and gather and be safe. But what's so safe if you've got drug dealers infiltrating and hookers?
About 500 needy people use the services provided by All Saints Church every day.
Oh, shut up.
What time you got, Ed?
Time on your watch, Ed.
Okay.
My
name is... Oh, man, everybody's coming out.
Don't push!
Go on, Jimmy, go!
The weekly rush at the food bank is reminiscent of the 30s.
This one's really sore.
Yeah, it looks swollen too.
I live on the third floor and I got a walk up.
There's some basic health care.
And you're gonna need some new socks today?
No, I'm okay.
How's that feeling?
Good.
Good. A little bit more then?
Hey?
A little more?
I'm not complaining.
Okay.
And there's room to sleep in the pews. $500 a day and rising. The activists asked the church to extend its hours. The center was agreeable, the residents were not. They think the church sustains the dealers and the hookers.
Yeah, we are feeding and sustaining drug dealers and hookers. They're people who, if they're hungry, need to be fed too. We have a no tolerance policy here for not allowing dealing and those kinds of things to happen in our centers, but we certainly don't turn away somebody who needs a meal, who we may know or may suspect deals drugs or has a drug habit or is an alcoholic or might turn tricks out in the street or that kind of thing. Because, I mean, who are we to judge?
And you have to take this very seriously.
The residents took their complaints to the city councilor. Kyle Ray listened, took up their cause, and went right to the top.
Hire a private police force to get rid of crack dealers next door.
I had the Archbishop in here about 3 years ago and just laid it on the line with him that in fact he was a very bad neighbor.
The bishop sued for peace. Among other things, he agreed to install 6 surveillance cameras, and it's put pressure on the drug and sex trade.
Are you comfortable with surveillance cameras on your church?
I didn't think I would be. On one hand, I'm not, but on another hand, I'm really grateful for them because we were spending too much time being the police ourselves, and that took away from the work that we wanted to do.
Having the Archbishop in here with his staff and saying, you need to form policies that respect your neighbors, I think had a profound effect.
Big deal. Does the church feel bullied? Sure. We've had nasty letters, we've had nasty phone calls, we've had faxes sent to the city and to the bishop. People have in the past made effort, you know, to close down programs.
They're good people, but sometimes also they're overwhelmed.
Gaetan Heroux, who works in a shelter, was one of the activists who asked the church center to extend its hours.
The residents have gone to the All Saints Church to put pressure on them to be more hard line on, in particular, I guess they argue, the drug trade. And the church has bowed down to that.
The residents complained about Aru's attitude. He lost his job. Aru is one of the leaders of the anti-poverty group OCAP. When he figured out who'd gotten him fired, OCAP stormed across the street and laid siege to Renee Auer's bed and breakfast. Auer was not amused.
Picking on me and marching on my house is no way to change policy. As far as I'm concerned, they do not speak, you know, for the poor or the homeless or whoever, because I think a lot of people just think they're nuts.
John Clark of OCAP thinks Auer complains too much.
I mean, I've had the cops come to my home
when I wasn't there and try to intimidate my family. I've had on one occasion people pull up in a car and put 20 rocks through the windows of my house. I mean, that's somewhat more substantial than a picket. A picket in front of my house would be a joke as far as I'm concerned.
My question is, who funds these people?
Canadian auto workers, Buzzard Groves.
Okay, I knew they did, but I think it's time that maybe we have to take OCAP on and take on the people who sponsor them.
A resident, a union official, complained to the Canadian auto workers, who provide a third of OCAP's budget. The CAW came back to John Clark with an ultimatum.
They had received a letter from the residents' association complaining about our behavior and complaining about specifically the tactic of picketing the homes of some of these people. The end result is that Buzz Hargrove, the president, has made the determination that unless we're prepared to give them an assurance that this tactic will never be repeated again, all support for OCAP is going to end immediately.
Dundas and Sherbourne is the center of a growing epidemic of homelessness in Toronto. Every morning, the parks and pavement are lined with sleeping bodies. The first small step off the street is into rooming houses, like the one at 214 Sherbourne. 12 people live here. A single man gets about $500 a month from welfare. Here he pays $400 in rent. There are a lot of rooming houses near the four corners, but still not enough. There's pressure to open abandoned buildings to add space.
You can't realistically, in a situation where people are freezing to death on the streets, own a property, board it up for your own speculative interest, and be at all surprised when the people who are affected by that housing crisis organize to take back that housing.
The Ontario Coalition Against Poverty smashes into empty buildings and occupies them on behalf of the homeless.
Use it! Use it! Use it!
And there's buildings like this that could readily house people that are left standing idle.
Sometimes this is peaceful, sometimes not.
We have our fair share. It is time to move it around the city.
Renee Auer agrees there should be more low-income housing, but not here, particularly not at 214 Sherbourne, where the landlord wants to add three rooms.
Okay, do I have everybody here for 214 Sherbourne Street?
The residents go to City Hall to stop the additions.
Property will be providing much needed rooms for certain members of our community that are not exactly well-to-do.
Is it the basement apartment new?
Yes, it is.
Give the neighbors an opportunity to have their turn here.
I live right smack in the middle of an entire block of rooming houses presently. Some of them are in very bad shape. I mean, I know there has to be rooming houses. I live in the middle of them, and I live with these people every day. But let's give them a quality of life. If that's what you want to do, that's fair. But let's make it so that they can enjoy their room, their little kitchenette. Thank you.
Thank you. An opportunity to everybody.
Our client, she's worked in hands with...
The lawyer has an ace up his sleeve.
...provided to the community some letters of support, one from the All Saints Church Community Center. And if I may highlight very briefly a quotation from this letter. While the shelter that she offers is no way luxurious, it does offer housing to people with very acute need, people who would otherwise likely be homeless.
The church's letter does the trick.
I think I am willing to support this application, and so therefore we'll be granting this item this evening. So thank you.
214 gets its three rooms. The residents lose this one.
Okay, we're on to item number 7, which is 14 Gilgorm Road in Ward 22, North Toronto.
Just one little thing about the rooming houses and the ones that are directly across from your door. Went to the committee.